The being richest in overflowing vitality, the Dionysian god and man, may not only allow himself the spectacle of the horrible and questionable, but even the fearful deed itself, and all the luxury of destruction, disorganization, and negation. With him, evil, senselessness, and ugliness seem, as it were, licensed, in consequence of the overflowing plenitude of procreative, fructifying power, which can convert every desert into a luxuriant orchard. This video is part 2 on our discussion on Nietzsche's mistake. Watch part 1 by clicking the link below. In that video, we went over what Nietzsche calls his mistake concerning the Romantic era and what that means for art and culture. Nietzsche assumed Wagnerian music and Schopenhauerian philosophy were the products of an overflowing vitality or a surplus of life. However, in The Joyful Science, he changes his mind. It was a mistake to think Wagner and Schopenhauer are a product of exuberance. Rather, Wagner and Schopenhauer are the product of a lack of vitality. Wagnerian art and Schopenhauerian philosophy thus represent the tyrannical will of a sorely suffering, struggling, or tortured being who would like to stamp his most personal, individual, and narrow characteristics, the very idiosyncrasy of his suffering, as an obligatory law and constraint on others, who, as it were, takes revenge on all things in that he imprints, enforces, and brands his image, the image of his torture, upon them. The late Nietzsche is of course vehemently opposed to art of this kind. Most notably in his work The Case of Wagner, we find a long polemic that seeks to critique Wagner's music and with it Schopenhauer's philosophy. If there is enough interest, we might do a separate video on Nietzsche versus Wagner. Comment below if you're interested. But this video is not about criticism. In this follow-up video, we want to take a look at what kind of art this late Nietzsche considers good. If bad art proceeds from a lack of vitality, what kind of art proceeds from a surplus of vitality? In the paragraph of The Joyful Science in question, Nietzsche drops 4 names. Art may proceed from gratitude and love. Art of this origin will always be an art of apotheosis, perhaps dithyrambic, as with Rubens, mocking divinely, as with Hafiz, or clear and kind-hearted, as with Goethe, and spreading a Homeric brightness and glory over everything. Notably, Nietzsche names 1 painter and 3 poets, but not a single musician. If we take a quick look at Nietzsche's writings in his unfinished book, The Will to Power, we read the following. Homer as an apotheosis artist. Rubens also. Music has not yet had such an artist. However, we can reasonably conclude, when we read Nietzsche contra Wagner, that the musician who comes closest to this Dionysian ideal of the late Nietzsche would be Georges Bizet with his opera Carmen as his magnum opus. All these artists mentioned by Nietzsche have works that stress vitality, dynamism, and an overflowing of life. Let's look at the Encyclopaedia Britannica entry for Peter Paul Rubens. Rubens is the greatest exponent of Baroque painting's dynamism, vitality, and sensuous exuberance. Concerning the works of Goethe and Hafiz, a Persian poet and theologian, Nietzsche wrote, "Finally, even the complaisant and wanton surrender to the emotions, as has been taught by Hafiz and Goethe, the bold letting go of the reins, the spiritual and corporal licentia morum in the exceptional cases of wise old codgers and drunkards, with whom it no longer has much danger." Nietzsche is looking for art that was created out of gratitude for life, not hatred. Art that recognizes human emotions and isn't afraid to let them take the upper hand. Art that, in Nietzsche's words, spreads a Homeric brightness over everything. There is a passage in The Joyful Science in which Nietzsche is speaking about so-called Homeric happiness, but really, the passage shows how we might think of this new kind of art which is envisioned by Nietzsche. To have fine senses and a fine taste, to be accustomed to the select and the intellectually best as our proper and readiest fare, to be blessed with a strong, bold, and daring soul, to go through life with a quiet eye and a firm step, ever ready for the worst as for a festival, and full of longing for undiscovered worlds and seas, men and gods. To listen to all joyous music, as if there, perhaps, brave men, soldiers and seafarers, took a brief repose and enjoyment, and in the profoundest pleasure of the moment, were overcome with tears and the whole purple melancholy of happiness. Who would not like all this to be his possession, his condition? It was the happiness of Homer, the condition of him who invented the gods for the Greeks, nay, who invented his gods for himself. But let us not conceal the fact that with this happiness of Homer in one's soul, one is more liable to suffering than any other creature under the sun. And only at this price do we purchase the most precious pearl that the waves of existence have hitherto washed ashore. It would be impossible to look at poems by Hafiz, literature by Goethe, paintings by Rubens, epics by Homer, and music by Bizet in any kind of detail in a video like this. Rather, we hope this video serves as inspiration. We hope you want to explore these artists with this knowledge in mind. And even if we could do a deep dive into art history and Nietzschean aesthetics, there is the main problem that Nietzsche himself doesn't really know what to expect. He is primarily talking about art from the future. In Beyond Good and Evil, Nietzsche presented his vision for a philosophy of the future. But that's just what it was, his vision, the first step. Nietzsche did not live long enough to complete the task, and you could say it is up to us to finish it. The same goes for so-called Dionysian art. It was to be an artwork of the future. In the sketches of his planned book, The Will to Power, we can find some hints and bits and pieces as to what Nietzsche was getting at, but his aesthetics in this sense have never been fully systematized. Of course, we do know that the Dionysian doesn't like order, definiteness, or calculation. The Dionysian is free, light, overflowing, living, chaos. Uncharted territory waiting to be explored. Thank you for watching, and we'll see you in the next one.